by more and less choice, you know, so you can say by choice that I've been, you know, taking into consideration and culture because why not even know that influences what you believe your choices are. And I definitely know kind of from, you know, the beginning that, yeah, it wasn't her, like, financially. I don't think I know a lot of people were able to get off the streets, but, you know, everyone just says I'm not going to pay my loans, and it's not necessarily something that I'm doing 4 years later. And it's been a very scary reality as I'm 26 now, and sort of watching, you know, a lot of my friends try, who I know have been homeless for a long time, get off the streets and deal with this, and they have absolutely. They don't understand it, you know, and it's, there are, even though we live in this town, Olympia, where I don't think we have such a harsh mental connotation of the community of homeless, if you're saying that we see each other as community much more than other places, we still, you know, it is still terrifying that we don't communicate and share these tools with each other. And that's something I definitely feel like kind of resonating a lot with, like, kind of, you know, I'm still a little passionate. Things I don't do, it's very easy to reflect on things I've seen my friends go through. You know,
we don't have, you know, a centralized way of finding out up-to-date information. You know, I've got flyers that have been printed out that show all sorts of useful information from a couple of years ago. Phone numbers have changed, what's the guy? And you know, that can be difficult because, okay, I finally talked myself into getting motivated so that I can get out of this hole. What's step one? Where do I go? A lot of times I'll just, you know, keep a hold of your motivation and, you know, like the next day it's like, you've got to convince yourself you're working on it.
That's what I see being on the, as kind of other, I mean, on the inside of social services that when there is a pot of money that comes into the community, everyone's fighting against, I mean, I don't want to say this is what always happens, but people get a little cagey and they want to grab that pot of money and reinvent something that maybe somebody partially invented over here that's a great solution and somebody else did. And that if they just came together and relaxed a little bit, there's probably a lot left over for resources for everybody in the end. Maybe not a lot, but more than it takes to everybody in these little planets creating their own solar system. It doesn't work out.
Ken, when we do this, the solution is is there anybody, because we don't have a lot of time left, there's 7 minutes until seven, is there anybody who hasn't spoken who has something burning to say about homelessness for their community?
I was homeless for about 2 years when I was a kid, and not by choice, and most of what everybody has said is totally resonating with me, but one thing I really agree with is the, what you were saying about, like, skill sharing and lack of information. So I remember the first time I tried to get a job when I was homeless, and it was a joke, like, you know, I had no work history, I had no address, like, it was just, it was impossible, and I think that, you know, most people just get kind of cut out of the loop of the community and aren't benefiting from the things that other people know how to do, and it took me a really long time to marginalization and the criminalization is horrible, but I just think the isolation and the, you know, the not, I don't know, my review that said, like, whoever said, most people are not in the community, they're part of the community. This is the community, the people that live here too. And the recent things that have been happening are really, really frustrating for me just because there's this attitude that they're not part of the community. If they had that attitude about, like, say, people of color, would they get away with it? You know? Somehow it's okay to do it when it's economic. I really think that as a community, we, like, absolutely just have to take a stand and just say it's unacceptable at all.
I was at a workshop once at Evergreen where, like, this person that was like it was a healing workshop, and people from different identities, we gathered together, and then, like, the facilitator, they mentioned a certain identity, like a woman, a person of color. Some people went across the room who identified with them, and then at the end of the workshop, you know, she shared with us that whenever she did the workshop, her nephew or something, he went across the room, walked across the room with the women, because even though he knew he wasn't a woman, he, like, identified with them, you know, because they were her sisters, or they were his parents and stuff. So I think there is a power when, even though we may not fit the exact definition of homelessness, if we all just embrace that or, like, identify with it, not in, like, a superficial way, but in a deep way, because if you really look at the root of, like, capitalism and colonization, we're all, like, homeless people. We've all been, like, pushed away from some, like, something, you know? And for me, I feel like I can, as you were getting off the definitions, I realized something. For me, I look back to my personal story, and, like, I was adopted, you know? So my earliest years were in a foster home, and I bet you could find a big correlation between, like, homelessness and, like, the foster system. And if you consider, like, a foster home, maybe it's not even really a home, you know, then I would totally be included in that. And so, yeah, I just want to, like, say something to, like, continue with this idea that, yeah, we are, it is us, and they are our community, and there is no homeless in us. It's like, they are us, and these ordinances that are passing is not, they're not just for homeless people, even though they're targeted at homeless people, they apply to all of us. So,
certainly have. I sometimes invite the homeless that I talk to when they look at me. You know, I'm white, I'm male, I wear a tie. And I ask them, I say, do you think you can look at somebody, tell if they've ever been homeless? I won't go into my personal story about why I was homeless. I mean, it basically mattered to the state taking my home. I had a home. And I lost the state. But what I'd like to say that to the homeless, when you're talking to people that, in, you know, a part of the community that aren't homeless, is it doesn't stop just with the homeless. We are, in a sense, all homeless, because the homeless are easy to stigmatize because they're more recognizable. They don't have walls to protect their privacy. They're out in public. But these public spaces, like the streets that belong to all of us, it doesn't stop with the city passing anti-poverty laws that target the homeless. They target those of us that aren't homeless in the traditional sense too. They will kick you out of public facilities just because they have the power to do so, not even justifiably. They will tell you, you know, what you can say, you know, when you can say it. The oppression goes beyond just this issue. It's pandemic. And I just want to say one thing, that don't ever give up hope, that the fact that you may be homeless now is not mean that it's a fatal disease, that you're going to be homeless forever. And there are people who generally appreciate the homeless because you have the truth. And you don't have these other issues that hide the truth or distract you. You have the truth, and the truth tellers is what's going to eventually make the ultimate difference.